Fountain family and friends. Welcome to another exciting week of blessings and joy as we gather once again. I'm Corey Lee.
And I'm Brittany Lewis. Welcome to the Fountain of Praise, a place of refreshing. We're glad that you're here and have chosen us as your place of worship today.
That's right. Let's see what wonderful events and updates we have happening with our church family this week. And remember, anything can be found at tfop.org/connect. Today is Women's Day, and we're celebrating in style. Ladies, it's a beautiful sight to see all of you in your green, turquoise, and yellow. We really appreciate you all for being so connected with our mission and efforts to share Christ.
I promise you will feel graced by God after hearing from our women's choir and guest speaker, Pastor Shalandria Taylor.
You will be so blessed, so enriched, and full after today's service. We'll be checking in with you in the lobby after each service today and in the comments online. There's also a few lobby tables for women to get connected with ministries at TFOP.
Next month, we're hosting our highly anticipated new members orientation. Whether you're new to the faith or new to our church, this is your chance to get connected and dive deeper into your spiritual journey. Join us to learn about our many ministry opportunities where you can get involved, make friends, and make a difference. Our team is here to support you as you begin your new walk with Christ. New members orientation will be held May 18th, and you can sign up today.
Looking for something special to do with your spouse? Join our Sacred Marriage Ministry for our monthly outing. Whether you're newlyweds or seasoned couples, this is your chance to keep the romance going for date night. So clear your schedules for April 26th, 7 p.m. at the Fountain Life Center, and come out and be blessed in your relationships.
Mother's Day is fast approaching, and nominations are now being accepted. We will recognize our most seasoned mother, our newest mother, our impactful mother, and community mother. If you know a deserving mom, head to our Connect page to fill out the form. Nominations end May 2nd.
Join us for our monthly online Prayer with Pastors. We will be live on Zoom, so join us for 30 minutes of prayer every last Wednesday of each month. Mark your calendars. The next Prayer with Pastors will be on April 24th from 6:30 to 7 a.m. with Pastor Dr. Remus Wright.
If you missed any of our details about our upcoming events, you can find all information at tfop.org/connect.
That's right. Let's stay connected. Follow and subscribe on our social media at The Fountain of Praise.
Again, happy Women's Day and a big welcome to all of our first-time visitors. We are glad you're here. Make sure to stop by one of the Agape Zones in the lobby as you exit the sanctuary. We have a gift waiting just for you. Thanks for choosing the Fountain of Praise. Now, let's go to worship.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Good morning, Fountain of Praise. My name is Sheila Lewis, and this is Talana Bean. We're here to represent the women's mission. And we just want to tell you to praise God, give God the glory, give him the praise. In behalf of our pastors, co-pastor, Pastor Remus Wright and co-pastor Mia Wright, we just want to just welcome you to the family of praise. And also we just want to give God glory, praise, and honor as Talana comes and bring the word. Bring forth the prayer this morning. Amen.
Let us go before the Father for a word of prayer. O most gracious and loving God, the lover of our soul, the one who made the heavens and the earth, mind regulator, heart fixer, the divine one, Jesus, we thank you, God, for this moment. We thank you for bringing us to the house, God. Lord, for it's Women's Day. And God, we thank you for our men, but God, we love our women and we say thank you, God. Lord, today there are women here who have brought depression, God. God, today we're bringing anxiety. God, we are releasing where our finances are short, God. We've had more month than we've had money. God, we release it today. God, we are asking, God, that you would bless us. us so heavenly, God. Lord, we are looking to do your work, God, anything that glorifies your name, Jesus. Lord, clean us up from the inside out. God, we know we look good outside, but God, inside some things are troubling, God. And today we release that to you, oh God. Lord, we pray for our children, God. Lord, this world is changing rapidly, God, and we ask that we know we can't be around them always. But God, you are there. You are there, here, and everywhere. We just say thank you. God, we pray for the sick and the shut-in today, God. Where the body is rocking with pain, God, we know you are a healer. We know you could be a doctor in the hospital, a lawyer in the courtroom, God. So today we pray for deliverance. And God, as the one brings the word today, I felt it, God. It's my time. It's your time. God, we just ask that you help us to walk in your purpose, God. Because where we are afraid, God, you know you've already made the way for us. So, God, as the one brings the word today, the fresh anointing, we pray, God, that there be a lifting in the souls, God, through the singing, through the speaking, through the teaching. We love you on today. In Jesus' name, we declare, God, when we lay stretched out or we go upwards, God, won't you give us a resting place in your thine kingdom? In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Hallelujah! Come on, anybody have a hallelujah in your spirit? Come on, anybody have a thank you, Jesus, in your spirit? How many of y'all glad to be alive and well today? Anybody grateful to have the activity of your limbs? I don't know about you, but I'm expecting God to do some great things on today. Oh, y'all quiet on me. Let me go over here. I don't know about you, but I'm expecting God to do some great things in my life, and I need for him to do it suddenly. How many of y'all want the Lord to fill you up again with more power? Come on. With more anointing. Ah, we need you right now. We need you, Jesus. Yes, sir. Won't you look up to heaven and say, God, fill me up again. Come on, say, fill me up again. Hallelujah. Everybody make some noise up in here. Come on, everybody put their hands together.
Oh,
on, let's put our hands together as Cross Praise Ministry comes.
It's impossible to please you, Lord. without faith, it's just impossible to please you, Lord, to please the Lord. Faith that can move mountains, faith that can calm the raging sea, oh, faith that believes in Jesus. Faith that sets the captive free. Ooh, faith. Without it, it's impossible to please the Lord. Without faith, it's impossible to please the Lord, to please you, Lord. Without faith, it's just impossible to please you, Lord, to please you, Lord. Faith that can captive free. Ooh, faith. Without it, it's impossible to please you, Lord. Lord, I need faith. Lord, I need faith.
I need faith
to move.
stay close to you, oh my Lord. I need faith, because without it, it's impossible. Wanna please you, Lord? I need faith.
Hallelujah! It's prayer time. Faith. Faith says, facing all, I trust Him. Faith. Facing all, I trust Him. It's prayer time. If you would like to be anointed, touch your finger to your forehead and our ministers will anoint you with oil. And if you are sitting in the middle of an aisle, we ask that you move out to the side of the aisle so that we may reach you more expeditiously. And for those of you that are watching by stream, we recognize that we faith in the spirit realm. We realize that no matter where you are, our prayer can touch what you need. It is by faith. Facing all, I trust Him. Trusting God. Our scripture reference comes from 2 Thessalonians 1:3. It says, I thank God that your faith is growing and your love is increasing. Your faith is growing and your love for your brothers and your sisters is increasing. And so now, God, I thank you. You are God. You have ordained God. Nobody made you God. Nobody taught you how to be God. You're just God. You are sovereign. You are deity. You are divinity. You are mighty. You are majestic. You are holy. You are ever-giving, ever-loving, ever-compassing. You are our fortress. You are God. You are our instructor. You are our teacher. You are our healer. You are our peace. You are God. You are God, and with you there is nothing that is impossible because you are God. And we use our faith, oh God, faith in your sovereignty, faith in your deity, faith in your divinity, faith in your power that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. God, we thank you. God, we bless your holy and your mighty name that you allowed us to come to the altar, that you gave us a mind and a spirit to know that I need God no matter what's in my week. It doesn't matter. What matters is who is in my week and who goes before me. Your word tells us that you would teach us and you would guide us in the way of instruction. Your word teaches us that you would never leave us or forsake us. Your word tells us that you hold us by your mighty right hand, and therefore we can face anything by faith. God, you said it's not the size of our faith, but it's the quality that's in our faith. Our faith is qualified to move mountains. Our faith is qualified for sickness to be removed. Our faith is qualified to get it empowered on that position. Our faith has the quality to move to the next level. Our faith has the quality to believe that our children are kept safe in their classrooms. It's the quality of our faith, oh God. And so now, God, I pray right now for those around this altar. Somebody came to the altar by faith, believing that you were healing every abnormality in their body. Your word says that we are formed and framed after your image and in your likeness. And because of that, no sickness is in you, no sickness is in our body, because your word says so. God, we thank you right now. Somebody around this altar has a confused mind, oh God. Your word says that we are healed in the spirit of our mind. So I speak to that lie called depression. I speak to that spirit called confusion. I speak to that spirit called I'm overwhelmed. Peace in the name of Jesus. Peace in the name of Jesus. Be in peace in the name of Jesus. And now, God, I thank you. Somebody is coming to this altar praying for their children, God. The prodigals that will come home. The prodigal will return, and they will return with a testimony. The prodigal will return home, and they will return with a testimony. God, I thank you. God, I bless you. God, I honor you. God, I'm praying for the married couple today by faith, standing together. I'm praying for that business venture. By faith, let it prosper. I'm praying for that educator in the classroom. By faith, give her wisdom how to teach our children. By faith, oh God, we do it. We do it and we face it. By faith, we trust God. Can God? God can. Can God heal your body? God can. Can God help my mind? God can. Can God give me financial increase? God can and God will. In the name of Jesus, amen, and so be it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, if you receive that prayer. You've been asking yourself if God can. Tell yourself, God can. Can you, God? Say, yes, God can. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm going to give a moment for those who are coming in as you go back to your seats. We just really want to thank God for this day. Amen. Come on. How many of you want to bless God for today? Things change, right? It was hot yesterday. Today is cold. You might have come in here with a problem today, but I guarantee you're going to leave out with an answer, because God is the answer. When I was a kid, they used to sing a song, say, Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him, there's no other, because Jesus is the way. Come on, look at somebody and say, Jesus is the way. Jesus is the way. Welcome to our second wave of Fountain Fent family coming in today. We thank God for you. And for those who are watching on the stream, we bless God for you and we welcome you into the fellowship today. It's our Women's Day. And what a blessing it is to celebrate and honor the work of God's women in the kingdom of God. Amen? Come on, I'm going to say that again. It's our Women's Day. We haven't had one in a while. And it's good to look out here today and see sisters in their greens and blues and yellows. And even if you didn't wear those colors, I see some brothers too in it, yes. But we thank God for you. Want to lift up Pastor Wright. He is traveling today. He and Deacon Rito and Deacon Greg, they're traveling today. But as they come in on the airlines, we ask that God will give them traveling grace and mercy. They deserve a little break today, right? Amen. Amen. I want to recognize our Mayor Pro Tem, Martha Kastick-Tatum is here. Not a stranger to the fountain. We're always delighted to see you and welcome into the house today. Amen. Y'all, we got a preacher in the house today. Amen. Now, y'all know the Fountain of Praise. We love some good preaching. And we're used to good preaching. And I'm so grateful today that God has blessed me to connect with this young lady. She's a graduate of Texas Southern University. She's a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha sorority. Now, you non-AKAs, don't let that distract you. Amen. But y'all know, y'all already know. If you know, you know what they say. If you know, you know. That's what the kids say. But anyway, she's an intergenerational preacher, the daughter of a pastor. And she's formerly here in Houston, but now living in Sacramento, California, in the Bay Area. And we thank God for her being able to come and bless us with the word on today. She's currently pursuing her Master's of Divinity degree. And she's a young woman. But packaging all that littleness, little young petite things, is the fire of God. She is anointed and she is gifted. And God has blessed her with an old school anointing in today's relevant delivery. Amen? Amen. So after this fantastic women's singing group, amen, this women's choir led by Sister Melanie Bivens and Sister Pam Davis, after they deliver the next song, then the next voice we'll hear today will be Pastor Shalandria Taylor. If you would, just extend your hand towards where she is seated today and say, preacher, preach God's word. Amen. Come on, let's worship God. Thank you, Sister Melanie.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. We talked about faith. How is it possible to please God? But Lord, help our unbelief. We're asking, Lord, to release it, release it, release it, release it. Whatever blessing I need, Jesus, release it. I did hear the Texas Southern University. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. dancing in the room today. Are you ready? Get ready. It's already been released.
There's a blessing in this room today.
Oh.
Are you ready?
Get ready.
It's already been released.
There's a healing in this room today. blessing in this room today. There's a blessing in this room today. There's a blessing in this room today. There's a healing in this room today. There is joy in this room today. There is peace in this room today. There is joy in this room today.
Come on, I dare you to get what you need from the Lord. Come on, 30 seconds. Whatever you need. Whatever you need. Come on. Whatever you need. Whatever, whatever. Come on, 30 seconds of you getting what you need. Whatever you need. Come on. Whatever you need. Come on, whatever you need. Come on, you ought to reach up and get it. Come on, whatever you need. Come on, if it's joy that you need. If it's peace that you need. If it's deliverance, get what you need. Seconds, I dare you to clap your hands and open up your mouth like you know that the God you serve is getting ready to release something over your life. That ain't for everybody. I said clap your hands and open up your mouth and let the God of the Bible, the God that heals, the God that delivers, the God that sets free, the God that knows what you need, open up your mouth and begin to worship your God. Amen. We are so happy in the house and in the presence of our God. If you can sense the presence of the God, I dare you to clap your hands and begin to open up your mouth. Hallelujah. We are so grateful to be here back in the house in the presence of the Lord. Will you help me give God praise for the shepherd of this house? Come on, Dr. Wright. And we thank God for co-pastor. Amen. Dr. Mia Wright, we honor the Lord for you, and I'm so grateful to be here. Truly, it has been a blessing. Our first service, God moved, and when I walked into the room, he shifted me somewhere else. Amen. So we got to obey the word and the voice of the Lord. Let's go very quickly to the word of the Lord. We thank God for this awesome anointed music ministry. We give God praise for them. Amen. Let's go to, I want to start at John 11, verse 43, if I can. John 11, verse 43. Amen. We thank God for the presence of the Lord that is already here. Amen. John 11, verse 43. Two verses in your hearing, and it reads, "And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he that was dead came forth bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus saith unto them, loose him and let him go." I want to take our thought from verse 44. It says, "And he that was dead came forth bound hand and foot with face, and his face was bound about with a napkin. Jesus saith unto them, loose him and let him go." For the next few moments, I want to minister from the subject, "I don't look like what I've been through." Do me a favor and look at somebody across the aisle and say, "Neighbor, I don't look like what I've been through." They don't believe you. You ought to look behind you and testify and tell somebody, "Neighbor, I don't look like what I've been through." You may take your seats in the presence of the Lord. I don't look like it. I know I got this nice dress on today, but I don't look like it. I know you see this suit, but I don't look like it. I know you see this hair done, but I don't look like what I've been.
I like when I don't even have to go through the whole text and somebody catches a revelation already. I don't. Amen. We are reading here out of the book of John. And John is what we have come to learn or understand as the conclusions of the Gospels. What we also learn is that these Gospels are all written to particular sets of people. Matthew's Gospel were written to the Jews, and he was trying to convince them that this was the Messiah that they had been looking for. And then we have our dear brother Mark, who was not a part of one of the 12 apostles. In fact, Mark got his information from his spiritual father, Peter. And Mark's Gospel were written to the Romans, who could not understand why anyone would want to follow a man who died a common criminal's death. And then we have our dear brother Luke, my favorite gospel. Luke's gospel were written to the Greeks, and he was trying to convince them that beyond all of their philosophy, they still needed to know who this man named Jesus was. And then we have our dear brother John. John's gospel was not written to a particular set of people, but John wanted you to know in one and one that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. John wanted you to know in 1:14 that it was the Word that became flesh and dwelt among us. John wanted you to know in 3:16 that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. John wanted you to know in 14:6 that I am the way, the truth, and the light, and no man cometh to the Father but by me. John said, beyond of your philosophies and who you think you follow, you need to know who this man named Jesus was. My question to you this morning, is there anybody in the building that's glad that Jesus found you right where you were? I know him for myself. In this text this morning, we are going to be dealing with miracles. And in the common denominator of all of these miracles is that Jesus had the audacity to raise somebody from the dead. I want us to pay attention to the way that God, Jesus, God in the flesh, responds to women in this Bible. If you go with me to Mark chapter 5, you will be introduced to a man named Jairus. And the Bible says that Jairus came to Jesus and said, Lord, my daughter is sick until the point of death. I need you to come and see about her so that she can live. The Bible says that Jesus gets up and makes his way to Jairus' home, but on his way to Jairus' house, he stops and has a conversation with a woman who has an issue. The Bible says this woman said within herself, if I could but touch the hem of his garment, then I know that I will be healed. The Bible says now that this woman receives exactly what she says within herself. The Bible says that when she touches Jesus, she receives her healing. Now we think, because we read the Bible real fast, we think that her healing is the first miracle that she received. No, my brothers and sisters, that is the second miracle she received. The first miracle she received is this. How in the world do you bleed for 12 years and not die? How in the world are you able to give and give and give and still have the faith to believe that God will do more? This woman was a walking, talking miracle. I don't know who you're sitting next to, but I can guarantee that you are sitting next to a miracle this morning. I should not be here, but I am. Tragedies have hit me, but I'm here. I am a miracle. The Bible says that when this woman touches Jesus, Jesus feels virtue leaving from him, and he begins to ask his disciples. He said, who in the world touched me? And his disciples are confused. They said, Lord, there's a lot of people around you. But what his disciples did not understand is that though there always may be a lot of people around Jesus, very few have the ability to touch him. In other words, I know that I could have sat at home and watched this online, but I came into the house of the Lord in the presence because I need a touch from him. Now, I need something that he can only give me. That's not the best part. The Bible says that after this, he says to her, daughter, your faith has made you whole. Mm-hmm. The Bible says that when Jesus exposes her and begins to ask her questions, the Bible says that she begins to tell Jesus all all of the truth. She tells him the truth about her situation. She tells him the truth about what she's dealing with. She tells him the truth about how she trusted people who were supposed to heal her, and they didn't have the wisdom or the knowledge or the wherewithal to get her where she was going. In fact, every time they touched her, her situation got a little bit worse. This woman, although she was embarrassed, began to tell Jesus the truth. And after she exposes her truth, Jesus says, "Daughter, your faith has made you whole." Now, wait a minute. In the beginning of the text, we see this woman when she was only healed. But after she exposes herself, she goes from being healed to being made whole. Well, what is the difference between being made healed and being made whole? I'm so glad you asked. When you are healed, we are talking about the physical body. When you are healed, we are talking about your flesh man. But when you are whole, he says, I'm talking about your spirit. In other words, when you are healed, we can still see the bandages. When you are healed, we can still hear the trauma in your responses. But he said, when I come to make you whole, I'll make it look like you were never sick in the first place. When I come to make you whole, I'll make it look like, oh God, that the devil never wanted to destroy you in the first place. He said, when I come that you might have life and life more abundantly. I don't want you just to leave healed. I want you to leave being made whole. Is there anybody in the building that says, I don't just want to be healed, but I want you to make me whole? Make me whole. Uh-huh. Well, while this woman is receiving her wholeness, someone calls from Jairus' house and says, do not trouble the master because your daughter is already dead. And Jesus looks at Jairus and says, fear not, only believe. Now, if I was Jairus, I would have had an attitude with Jesus, because I told you that my daughter was sick until the point of death, and you decided to wait and help somebody else when you should have been helping me. My question to you this morning is, can you handle in your moments or in your low seasons when it looks like your miracles may be delayed, but it does not mean that they are being denied? Mm-hmm. The Bible says that Jesus finally makes his way into Jairus' home. And when he comes there, there's a funeral procession already going on. There are mourners outside crying. People are weeping for the life of the little girl. And Jesus looks around and says, hey, why are you all crying? The little girl is not dead. She is only asleep. And do you know what happened next? The text declares that the same people that were crying and mourning for the life of the little girl begin to laugh and mock Jesus. And Jesus does something that I've adopted in 2024. The next verse says that he puts them out. In other words, he says, I do not need your low faith level messing with the expectation of this miracle that I'm getting ready to perform for this man. So I will put you out. I don't care how long we've been Facebook friends. If you keep speaking against the miracle that I'm believing God for, I will put you out. I understand that I cannot choose my family, but I'm believing God for something that I don't expect low level and low faith people to understand. So I will put you out. Is there anybody in the building that'll do like Jesus? And the next time someone speaks against your level of faith, what you gonna do? We gonna put, I heard somebody say, put them out. The text says, believers, that after he puts them out, he only allows three people into the room with the little girl aside from her parents. Peter, James, and John. I told you that Jesus was just in a multitude full of people. He was just around many people, but he only allowed a few into the room to experience this miracle. Can I help you? Mm-hmm. There are some of our miracles, not us, the church down the street. There are some of our miracles being delayed because you keep trying to pull a multitude into a place where only a few can really handle what God is trying to do on your life. You think everybody wants to see you blessed. Not so. You think that everybody is on your side, and God says, I'm trying to get you to another level of faith, but you keep trying to pull everybody with you. And the more that you are pulling, it is slowing you down. He says there are only a few people that can really handle what God is doing in your life. Somebody shout yes. Uh-huh. God. He only allows Peter, James, and John into the room with a little girl. The Bible says that Jesus touches the hand of the little girl and says, Talitha kumai, which means, damsel, I say to you, arise. That's miracle number one. If you go with me to Luke chapter 7, around the 11th verse, Jesus is entering into a city called Nain. And in this city, there's a funeral procession going on for a young man. And the Bible informs us that his mother is a widow, and this is her only son. Well, why does the Bible tell us this? It tells us this because this woman could be headed to a very destitute or poor lifestyle because she has no male heir there to carry on the inheritance that belongs to her. But I'm so glad that Jesus, in all of his wisdom, knowing what this woman is dealing with, if you know anything about Jewish customs, it was almost illegal for a woman to speak to a man that was not a part of her kindred. I said it was socially frowned upon for a woman to speak to a man that she was not related to. So even if the woman saw Jesus, she could not make her request known out loud because she would be ostracized for it. But I'm so glad that Jesus has enough wisdom to know that sometimes he will take your private prayers and turn them into public miracles. I said there are some prayers that you are too afraid to pray out loud. There are some prayers that are not socially welcoming. But Jesus says, I don't care what your prayer request is. Every prayer you've prayed, every tear you have cried, I'm getting ready to make private public to let the world know that tradition cannot hold me from getting to you. Governments cannot keep me from getting to you. Sicknesses cannot keep me from getting to you. Depression cannot keep me from getting to you. Whatever private prayer you have, he said, I'm getting ready to turn it into a public miracle. Prove it in the text. God says, I am able to do exceeding abundantly above all you can ask or, wait a minute, think. That means that if I have the audacity to think it, then God's got the power to perform it. I'm not talking to everybody. I'm just talking to a few faith-filled people in the room to say, even if I never open up my mouth, I got a mind that says, I'm ready for what God wants to do in my life. After this miracle is now where we come into the circumference of our text in John 11, where they tell Jesus, Lazarus, the brother of Mary, the brother of Martha, the one you love is sick and he is getting ready to die. Jesus says, well, this sickness is not until the point of death, and in fact, I think I'll wait a few days before going and seeing about my friend. The problem that I have with the text, Dr. Wright, is that in the previous miracles, Jesus gets up immediately and he goes and sees about these people. But you tell me that Lazarus is someone that you love, someone that you have spent time with, and you decide to wait before you go and see someone that you love. I got a problem, because what do you do when love lets you down? How am I supposed to react when the God that I say that I love, the God that I live for, the God that I pray to, does not come at the anticipated time when I expect him? There was a song that came out when I was a little girl that said, he may not come when you want him, but he'll be there right on. My question to Jesus is sometimes, what time are you coming? Because the longer you wait, the more depressed I become. The longer you wait, the more I have to explain to people who you are. The longer I wait, the more embarrassed I am that you are not answering me at the time when I needed you to answer me. How am I supposed to react when sometimes, because you don't answer me when I need you, I question whether or not you love me in the first place? Understand here, Jesus waits before going and seeing about his friend. He finally decides to get up and he makes his way into the city of Bethany. The word Bethany in this context translates into the word misery. But when Jesus walks into the city of misery, when he crosses over the line, it goes from being the city of misery to becoming the city of miracles. Can I help you? You are just one step away from coming out of the most miserable place in your life and entering into a city of miracles. The Bible says that when Jesus comes into this city, that the elder sister comes out. And she says, Lord, had you had been here, my brother would not have died. And the Bible says that Jesus and Martha begin to converse, where he tries to convince her of who he is. He tries to convince her of his deity. He tries to convince her of his power. And the Bible says that he asks her a simple question. He says, do you believe that you will see your brother again? She says, yes, Lord, I know I see him in the resurrection. He said, no, I am the resurrection, and you are going to see your brother again. That's not the best part. The Bible says that when they finish their conversation, the youngest sister, Mary, comes up, and the Bible says that she says the exact same phrase that the elder sister says. She says, Lord, had you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I need us to pay attention to the way that he answered Martha, but he moved for Mary. Look in the text. We read the Bible too fast. He answers Martha, but he moves for Mary. Well, how is that? And they have the same exact phrase. They say the exact same thing. I want to point out that there is one small thing that Mary does that Martha simply does not. The Bible says that when she sees Jesus, the first thing that Mary does before she complains, before she tells him about her problems, before she tells him about her trauma, the first thing she does is she lays down on her face. It is the word pipto in the Greek. It means to come from a high place to a low place. In other words, she says that before I tell you how much more I cannot take, I'm going to make a decision to worship you first. Before I tell you what they did to me, I'm going to worship you first. Before I tell you how sick my body feels, I'm going to worship you first. Before I tell you how I have been mistreated, I'm going to worship you first. What I like about Mary is that Mary did not need to be convinced about the greatness of God in the flesh. Mary did not need to be convinced about him being a miracle worker. Mary was just happy that Jesus showed up, because Mary had a revelation that as long as Jesus shows up, miracles show up with you. When Jesus shows up, healing shows up with him. When Jesus shows up, joy shows up with him. When Jesus shows up, peace shows up with him. You don't have to do nothing. All I need you to do is show up. And when you show up, I know you'll show out. Are there any Marys in the room that say, just show up? And I know you'll show up. I dare some Marys in the room to begin to clap your hands and open up your mouth for the King of Kings and the Lord. Just show up for me. That's all I need. You ain't got to say nothing. You don't have to go anywhere, because your presence is enough for me to know. He says, in the presence of the Lord, there is full. Y'all sit down. We're only in the middle of the text, and I feel my preach coming up. The Bible says that after he responds and he moves. The Bible said that after Mary lays down at his face and then begins to talk to Jesus, the Bible says Jesus wept, and then he said, show me the place where the dead was laid. The Bible says that when this happened, he tells them to move away the stone. And Martha, the elder sister, speaks up and she says, hey, Lord, sorry. I just want to let you know that he's already been dead for 4 days and his body stinks. And the Lord rebukes her and said, didn't I tell you that you would see your brother again? If some of us would be honest this morning, we're a lot more like Martha than we are like Mary. Because at the greatest time that Jesus was getting ready to perform one of the greatest miracles she's ever seen, Martha keeps opening up her mouth to tell him how bad the situation is. Martha keeps opening up her mouth to tell him that she doesn't think that a miracle can happen. Now, maybe the reason why some of our miracles are delayed is because you keep rehearsing what it used to be, when God says, I'm trying to show you something different. I'm trying to bring you into something different. I'm trying to show you that I am the God God that can still work a miracle on your behalf. Sometimes you got to learn how to do two words. Don't tell your neighbor, because I don't want no fights breaking out in here. Sometimes you just got to learn how to shut up. And when you be quiet, God can move on your behalf. When you be quiet, he said, I'll hold your peace and let the Lord fight your battles. I don't have to say anything because he's getting ready to show up just for me. The Bible says that he tells him, move away the stone. And then he prays a prayer out loud. He said, Father, I thank you that you hear me. And in fact, you hear me always. But because of the people, because of the unbelievers that stand by, I have to say this prayer out loud. And then he cries out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. Now, the problem that I have with the text here is that in the previous miracles, Jesus never calls their names. I didn't say he didn't know their names. I said he didn't call them by their names. Now, I had a confession in the 8 o'clock service, and I have another one for you at 10 o'clock. And I pray that you still like me after that. But again, if you don't, it's okay. I got a lot of love for myself. I will never forget a face, but I will always, almost always, forget a name. The only way that I remember your name is if you come around me frequently. The only way that I remember your name is if you give me a compliment every now and then. The only way that I remember your name is if we develop a relationship with one another. I said, Lord, why did you call Lazarus by his name? He said, I called Lazarus by his name because Lazarus came around me frequently. He said, I called Lazarus by his name because me and Lazarus had a relationship. In other words, he says, the reason why I have to call his name is to let whatever put him in that grave know that I'm taking it personal. When somebody knows your name, it is an indication that there is a relationship between us. And Jesus says, I got to call Lazarus by his name because I'm taking his miracle personal. I'm taking his healing personal. In other words, what you may be currently going through right now, he says, just hold on a little while longer because I'm getting ready to call your name. Your name is getting ready to come up in heaven. Your name is getting ready to hit the ears of God. I dare somebody in the room to open up your mouth and shout, call my name. I'm almost done. I'm almost ready. The Bible says now that when he calls Lazarus by his name, the Bible says that Lazarus does come out of the grave. However, he comes out, but the Bible says that he still comes out bound. Wait a minute, rewind it. Jesus didn't call my name, and I'm coming out of what I'm in, but I'm still bound. You know what that means for us? That you can have a calling on your life and still be bound. You can have a gift and still be bound. You can have an anointing and still be bound. You can be wealthy and still be bound. But it is until Jesus makes his way into your situation where something has to change. Now, I'm almost done. The Bible says that Lazarus was not only bound, but he was bound in three places: hand, foot, and face. There are three places where the enemy wants to bind you up: your hands, your feet, and your face. Well, what is the significance? Why does the enemy want to come after the hands? I'm so glad you asked. In your hands, we all have something called rigids, and when you are born, they put ink on your hand, put it on a piece of paper, and wham, 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 you have just become a citizen, whatever you were born. In other words, these things, these rigids are identifiers where we are able to identify who you are. The reason why the enemy wants to come after the hands is because he wants to come after your God-given identity. He does not want you to know that every time you look in the mirror, it's a reflection of the God that made you. Don't you know you make the devil nervous every time you decide to look yourself in the mirror and say, we're gonna do this today, we're gonna get through this today, no weapon formed against me shall prosper today. He's jealous because he understands that the DNA of a God rests on the inside of you. Not only does does he come after the hands, but he also comes for the feet. Feet are responsible for two things. They are responsible for your movement, and they are also responsible for your stability. It is something we call the locomotion. You thought it was a dance. No, my brothers and sisters, the locomotion is designed to get you from one place to another. Well, why in the world would the enemy want to come after my movement? According to Joshua 1:3, he said, every place your foot shall tread, I'll give it to you. And then he also says that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. He said, if I can come after your steps, then I can come after your progress. Not only does he want to come after your progress, but he wants to come after your stability. In Psalm, you know the scripture, it says, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth fruit in his due season. The reason why the enemy wants to come after your stability is because he wants to come after the fruit that you were designed to bear. Well, what is my fruit? My children are my fruit. What is my fruit? My children's children are my fruit. What is my fruit? The business that I'm supposed to have. What is my fruit? The education that I'm supposed to go into. What is my fruit? The next thing that God wants to do in my life. He said that if I can cut off your stability, then you will not bear fruit. That's not the last place. The last place where the enemy comes, after he comes for the hands, after he comes for the feet, he comes for the face. Well, why in the world would he come after the face? In your face, there are three very important senses that you need in order to experience the fullness of life: your eyes, your nose, and your mouth. He comes for the eyes. The Bible says he was bound in three places: hand, foot, and face. Well, why would the enemy want to come after the eyes? If you know anything about the eye, if you know anything about the anatomy of the eye, we really see things upside down. But it is our optic nerves that sends a message to the brain that tells it to turn the image right side up. In other words, the enemy's job in your life is to get you to continue to see yourself upside down. He wants you to see your situation upside down. He wants you to see your children upside down. He wants you to see your doctor's report upside down. But I'm so glad that he sent something into the earth called the Holy Ghost, that it helps us to see things the right way. Not only does he come after the vision, but he comes for the nose. The nose is not just responsible for smelling, but it is also responsible for helping your respiratory system. In other words, it helps you to breathe a little better. And according to Psalm 150:6, the Bible says, let everything that hath, praise ye the Lord. But if I do not have breath, then I cannot release a praise. And if I cannot release a praise, how is God going to hear me? And if God cannot hear me, how is he going to know that I need him? I want you to know that it's the same breath in Psalm 150:6. It is the Ruach of God that we find in Genesis, where he breathed life into Adam. I just came to tell a few believers in the room that God is getting ready to breathe fresh life into you. May the Spirit of God breathe on you. May the Spirit of God breathe on your family. Breathe on your children. Breathe on your body in the name of Jesus. Is there anybody in the room that's got a Psalm 150:6? Got a Psalm 34:1? I will bless the Lord and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. There's one thing that you cannot hold, and that is my praise, the breath of God. The last place where he comes, and I'm going back to Sacramento, California, is the mouth. The mouth is not just responsible for speaking. It is also responsible for chewing and digesting. And just like your natural man needs food to survive, your spirit man needs the word of God to survive. The reason why some of us, not y'all, you know, the church down the street, the reason why some of us go to and fro and we're not able to stand is because you don't have enough word in your life to sustain you. You don't know how to properly eat and give God back his word. There is one thing that the enemy cannot fight against, and that is the word of God. Do me a favor and look at somebody and say, neighbor, do you know the word of God? If you ever find yourself trapped in darkness, you got to go to Psalm 27:1. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Whom shall I be? be afraid. If you ever find yourself wondering whether or not you are going to lose your mind, you got to go to 2 Timothy 1 and 7, where it says, thou hast not given us the spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. If you ever find yourself needing direction in your life, you got to go to Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, where it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not into your own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct thy path. If you ever find yourself needing a little bit of strength, you gotta go to Isaiah 40 and 31, where it says, thou hast not given us the spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. If you need strength in your body, Isaiah 40 and 31 says, God, that if you, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their. If you ever find yourself going through an affliction, you got to go to Psalm 34, around the 19th verse, where it says, many of the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord shall deliver them out of them all. If you ever find yourself crying all night long, you got to go to Psalm 30, around the 5th verse, where it says, weeping may endure for one night, but joy, oh joy, it comes in the morning. If you ever find yourself wondering whether or not you're going to make it through the day, you got to go to Philippians 4 and 13. All things through Christ that strengthen me. If you ever find yourself getting a little weary, you got to go to Galatians 6 and 9, where it says, be not weary in well doing, for in due season you're going to reap if you faint not. If you ever find yourself in a season of suffering, you got to go to Romans 8 and 18. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory that shall be revealed to us. If you ever find yourself not knowing whether or not things are going to work out for you, you got to go to Romans 8 and 28. For we know that all things work together for the good of them who love the Lord and those who are called according to his purpose. If you ever find yourself thinking you're going to slip, you got to go to Jude 1 and 24. Now unto him who is able to keep me from falling. If you ever find yourself going through a valley, you got to go to Psalm 23. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Is there anybody in the building that's glad that you got a word from the Lord? Thine word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Is there anybody in the building that's glad that you know the word? Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, do you know the word? You ain't talking to the right neighbor, because the right neighbor would have raised their hands. I'm glad I know the word. I got to leave you alone, but before I do, I got to tell you The rest of the story, the Bible declares that when he calls Lazarus out, we don't know if he hopped out, we don't know if he skipped out. All we know is that Lazarus heard the voice of somebody who had the power to resurrect him out of a dead place. The reason why some of us are still stuck in our graves is because you keep responding to people who don't have power. The Bible says that after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, then you'll receive power. If you don't have no power, I need you to hold your prayers. If your prayers don't reach the ceiling, I need you to close your mouth. But I need people in my life who can get a prayer through. I need people in my life who can pray me through depression, pray me into healing, pray me into joy. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray. Is there anybody that knows how to get a prayer through? Shout it out. I got to leave you alone, but I got to tell you the rest of the story. The Bible declares that when he calls him out, he calls him out of the grave. And the text declares that Jesus tells them to unloose him and let him go. I said, Lord, I'm confused. Why did you not just do it yourself? And who in the world is them? He said, them is everybody who planned your funeral before Jesus got a chance to show up. Who in the world is them? Them is everybody that did not know that he knows your name. Them is everybody who left you for dead when they could have picked you up. I don't know who them is, but I came to tell somebody today that them will never have the victory over your life. Shout yes! I got to go. I got one more thing, Dr. Mir, and I'm going to my seat. He says, tell them to unloose him and let him go. I said, Lord, I'm confused, because in the previous miracles, you touched them. In the previous miracles, you laid your hands on them. Why did you not touch Lazarus? He said, I didn't have to touch Lazarus because I called Lazarus by his name. I gotta tell a few people, if the preacher don't touch you today, that's all right, because God knows your name. If Dr. Mia never preaches again, that's all right, because God knows your name. If Dr. Remus never prophesies again, that's all right, because God knows your name. Is there anybody in the building that's glad that God knows your name? He knows my address, knows my situation, knows what I'm fighting with, knows what I'm dealing with. I serve a God who knows who I am. Do me a favor and look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, I don't look like what I've been through. I look like the grave. I've been in a low place. I smell like it too. But thanks be unto God who gives me victory over my enemies. Is there anybody in the building that's ready to come out of your grave? Ready to come out of your low place? Do me a favor and grab a neighbor by the hand and say, neighbor, I'm pulling you out of the low place. I'm pulling you out of your grave. I'm pulling you out of your valley. I'm pulling you out of your situation. I'm pulling you. You don't belong in the grave. Tell them, get out of there. You ain't talking to the right neighbor. I said, shake them and tell them, come out of here. Come out of that grave. Come out of that low place. Come out of that dry place. Get yourself out of there and loose him. You got to loose yourself. off. Come on, I said shake it off. Depression is coming down now. Shake it off. Your healing is how I feel the Holy Ghost. Your healing is in the room now. I dare you to shake it off. Come on, 30 seconds. I got to take the dead clothes off because I'm alive. Matter of fact, I changed my address. Don't look for me in the grave. Aren't you glad you have to tell people your story because you don't look like the mess you've been through? Woo! Sometimes I just look in the mirror and I just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, for your keeping grace. Jesus, some of us ain't supposed to have no hair on our head. All the hair is supposed to be gone. And for those who have lost their hair, you're not even supposed to have your nerves. Your nerve's supposed to be gone. But God. We want to take a moment and extend an invitation to those who are looking for this testimony. You are seeking this testimony to be truly yours in your life. You want to be able to say, I don't look like what I've been through. You want to be able to stand before others and tell your story. Because God has truly brought you through, and people don't even recognize the depths of hell that God has lifted you out of. Today, we want to extend an invitation to anyone who is looking for that opportunity
The opportunity to trust God, the opportunity to follow God, the opportunity to see God lift you up out of your circumstance. And so we want to extend an invitation to Christ on this morning that you may come to know him in the pardon of your sin, that you may come to know him for the loving God that he is, that he sacrificed his son for you, that while you were still a sinner, that Christ died for you. Our deacons and our ministers are in the aisle to help extend this invitation so that your walk to the church will be a good one, a solid one, and let you know that you are not alone. There are others who have passed this way before, and our goal is to help you understand that you are never alone because God allows us to be part of the fellowship. Today, will you say yes to God? If you are here and you are asking God, what's next? The Lord says, stand up. I see you, sister. God bless you. Someone join this sister who has already broken the silence of saying, I say yes to God. I see you coming. God bless you. Stand up. Your heart just needs to say yes to God. And when you say yes to God, doesn't mean everything will be easy. I see you coming with your son. God bless you, sister. It doesn't mean everything will be easy, but it does mean that everything will be possible. For with God, all things are possible. Where are you? Come join those who have already made the sacrifice today to say yes. I see you, sister. God bless you. Someone else join the sister who is coming. Come. The doors of God's church are open. You may have never asked him to be Lord and Savior of your life. You may have never asked him, what is this Jesus thing that people have done? You've wondered about that, but today God has spoken to your spirit. And you say, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. I believe that he died and rose on the third day. I believe that he ascended to heaven and he is seated with the Heavenly Father. I believe that he has given me power through the Holy Spirit to operate in my life. And I believe that I can walk in victory because of him. If you're saying those things, today is your day. Say yes to Jesus. Stand up and come to the front. Someone is here waiting for you. Where are you? We're waiting for you. Where are you? We know that God has placed you in this place today. It's no happenstance. It wasn't an accident that you came today. Because God determined that today would be your day. There you are. I see you. God bless you. God bless you, sister. Brother, where are you today? The women have spoken today. The women have sung, but you can respond. You can respond because God is no respecter of gender. He doesn't respect male or female. He's made us children, his children. And so if you're in God's house today, he wants to see you. I see you, sister. God bless you. He wants you to make a decision for him. Come on. Come today. He is calling for you. God bless you, sister. He is calling for you. God is calling for you. And he wants you to be a part of his body. The choir is singing, my soul says yes. Deep down on the inside, if you're wrestling with that, let your soul yield to God. Let your soul say yes to God. Let your soul say, God, I'll trust you. God, I'll follow you. God, I'll be your child. And this will be the moment that God does something incredible for you. Where are you? Stand and come. Stand and come. We're waiting for you. Hallelujah. Somebody say harvest. Harvest. Thank you, Jesus, for those who have come on this morning to be a part of the body of Christ here at the Fountain of Praise. Amen? Amen. And with that, it is offering time. What a blessing it is that God gives us a moment to reflect back on the goodness of God in our lives and to give to him. We give him our praise. We give him our worship. But will we trust him out of what he has already given to us in our finance to give back to God? Can we trust God in this moment that God promises by his word that when we give, he says, it will come back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Can we trust that God's word won't lie? that he said he would give seed to the sower so that you may have bread? Can we trust that when we give, that God will allow us to receive back? Can we trust, as the Old Testament says, that if we bring the tithes into the storehouse, that God said, prove me and see if he will not open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing so big you wouldn't have room to receive it all? Can we trust God? That's what our giving reflects, the level of our faith and the level of our trust. And so today I encourage you to think upon the goodness of God in your life, the ability God has given you to work, to earn, to build a business, to go and give your collective thoughts to another group of people through an employer, and to serve and to work with their body and your hands and your mind and your mouth. And when God does that, he lets you earn. And then he asks for us to give something back to him. And today is our moment. Now is our moment to give that back. So can we trust God in this moment? Amen. Some of you can give in the app. You can give via text to give. You can give to the deacons as you exit out, or you can bring it or mail it to the church office. But however you give, let's hold it up before the Lord, and we're going to pray and speak a word over it. Father, this is my gift back to you, and I pray in the name of Jesus that you allow it to return back to me manyfold. God, I know that the kingdom needs my gift as well, and I thank you for allowing me the opportunity to give. God, I trust that you would not let anything be void in my life. Father, fill up my pantries. Father, fill up my bank account. Father, fill up my gas tank. God, fill up my spirit, oh God. Let my joy be full in you in the name of Jesus, oh God. And let not me lack, don't let me lack for anything in the name of Jesus. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. All right, hallelujah. As you're giving today, I want to thank God for that. I think I mentioned Pastor is traveling. Yes, I did. And we ask for your prayers as he is traveling. Should be back tonight. Before we start the mad dash, we want to ask our care disciples to please welcome in our new members who have come. So if we can shout out Harvest, we thank God for each of you. Please stand and come to the center aisle, and the care disciples are going to take you into the ministry rooms. We thank God for that. I want to recognize there are a couple things that are on the website before I turn it over to Minister Jay. A couple things on the website. And sisters, there are 3 lobby tables today that I encourage you to stop by. If you are called to the ministry, if you have a calling on your life and you've just been sitting, it's time to activate that calling. And so the Calling Ministry has a table out there. The WMU, the Women's Mission Union, also has a table in the lobby. And the Young Adults has a table in the lobby. We don't want to leave anybody out. So there's an opportunity for you to be able to stop by the lobby table today and sign up for one of the ministries. The second thing is that I want to encourage you to continue your spiritual growth and your journey. And there are several conferences that are coming up. Some of you are already familiar. Pastor Sarah Jake's conference will be coming up this week at Smart Financial Center in Sugar Land. If you go to our website, there is a 50% discount code. So go on the website. If you'd like to get a ticket, you can get 50% off. So you and your girlfriend can both go for the price of one. Amen? Amen. Don't buy one ticket, buy two. Yeah. All right. Then Kathy Taylor is hosting her conference this summer, the Refresh Her Conference, Refresh Her Experience. And I'm encouraging women to go and get tickets for that as well. It's not currently on the site, but it will be on the site later on today. So you can stop by and do that. Minister Jay, you had an awesome, awesome Bible study this week. And I thank God for you. I thank God for your life, son. I thank God for all the young adults. Pastor Sharondra is a young adult, too. Look what God is doing, y'all. Come on.
Amen.
Next gen of leaders.
Next
all
gen.
Right.
Amen. Well, we do have some elected officials that we need to recognize before we go. Running for Fort Bend ISD Board of Trustees position 6, we have Kristen Tassin here today. If you could just stand so everybody could see you. It is always a blessing when the people who are going to be looking after our children come to worship with us so we can tell what type of people they really are. Early voting starts tomorrow. Make sure you get down to the polls. Remember, Kristen Tassin. With that being said, let's stand, let's pray, let's go home. I pray that this week for you is a week of joy and not of sorrow, a week of victory and not of defeat. I pray that you are up and not down. I pray that everybody you encounter this week would be encouraged because of your positive Christian influence. I pray that you are the light in every room that you enter, that everyone that you touch might get a little bit of the Jesus that's on you, on them. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with us now, henceforth, and forever. And we say unto the Lord, amen and amen. Yams, I see you on Tuesday, 7:15.